The whole description of the world revolves around our experience. Now, scientific realism wants to take seriously and build into its metaphysics the idea that we are just, as it were, marginal additions to the world exists independently of us. Can I just go on? Because I think...
Yes, I don't suggest to get this in a minute, but go on.
Well, I think I may be able to put the protest. You see, I think that what a lot of modern philosophers, other philosophy would say, is, no, this is not so. We can represent in our language perfectly well the truths that the world exists independently of observers and that existed before we got here. All these philosophers would say is, we insist on, is that the language in which we describe any world, in which we describe any world, including the world without us, imaginatively, if we try to imagine a world without us, or the world as it was before we arrived, the language we use must be our language, and we learn it in terms of our experience, and all its sense must be in terms of our experience. And I suppose the most drastic form of that view in modern philosophy is, in fact, the philosophy of Wittgenstein. It's usually the Wittgenstein, more than anybody else, practically, in recent philosophy, was impressed by the idea that our language has the meaning we give it. It has the meaning which is derived from the way it's taught and is implicit in the way it's taught, and it can't reach out beyond the ways in which we are introduced to it. And you combine that also with a very radical and a very interesting set of reflections about the ways in which a practice or rule which has already been acquired can or can't bind you for the future. He saw that there was something mysterious about the idea of saying, as we do when we teach some rule of behaviour, because you've done so-and-so up to this point, you must do so-and-so in this next situation. He said, why am I not free?
Yes.
And would constantly come back to the thought that we found one way of continuing a practice, one way of developing a institution or so on, the necessary or obvious way, to come back to the idea that this was an anthropological fact.
Mm-hmm.
It's a fact about human nature. It might not even be, because he didn't really distinguish very much between, as it were, a psychological and an anthropological level here. It might even be a property of the group, not necessarily of humanity.
A form of life, he said.
A form of life. And Wittgenstein's famous equation of a language with a form of life, I think, enabled a form of life to be, in principle at least, one of a small group of people, of a tribe, a favourite example of his, or indeed of humanity.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes some of his propositions seem to be relative to humanity. But I must say, Wittgenstein never does what both Hume and Kant in different ways did try to do, which was to show exactly to what certain of these propositions were relative. I mean, Hume was very keen on trying to show that certain sorts of ways we had of going on were relative to the fact that we were human beings.
Yes, yes.
Kant was concerned showing that various ways we had of going on were relative to the fact that we were something slightly more general, relative to something slightly more general than human beings, namely creatures who found out about the universe serially through some kind of sensation. But Wittgenstein, opposed to theory, doesn't do that. He says, just look at what we do.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this means that in some, at least in its more parodial forms, I think Wittgenstein himself has often avoided this, but more parodial, it does lead to some extraordinarily odd results, doesn't it? Because it means that, in the end, they can't really be wrong if the thing is a going concern. I mean, let's take the...
all you could be wrong about, according to Wittgenstein, was in one's interpretation of what one is doing. I mean, he thought people were wrong to suppose that there were inner processes.
That's right, you had the wrong picture.
You had the wrong picture, yes.
You had the wrong picture. But
you had the wrong picture of your own behaviour in a certain sense.
You could have a wrong picture of your own behaviour, but that meant that every, and perhaps this is a very important idea in Wittgenstein,
mm-hmm.
that every fundamental form of learning, in regard to anything like philosophical learning, would necessarily be a piece of self-understanding. And this is what many people have found, as it were, the Socratic or almost existentialist element in Wittgenstein, that what we come to understand when we see we were wrong was some sense in which we've deceived or misled ourselves.
Well, about a narrow part of ourselves. I mean, misled about our use of language, in fact. But not misled about our characters or
well, that I think is not altogether clear. Because while indeed Wittgenstein tends to say always that what we are mistaken about is the nature of our language, his concept of our language is so generous that to be mistaken about our language is to be mistaken about our form of life. And therefore it's the way to have a wrong picture of what one is oneself fundamentally at. I think like everybody else who's working in philosophy now and has been brought up in this tradition, it would be preposterous and wrong to deny that one had been influenced very much by this work. I mean, it's
even if only negatively.
Partly because of the enormous imaginative power.
Yes.
I mean, there's such enormous.
Well, it's a great literary achievement.
Yes, it's a literary philosophy. I mean, it's, of course, it's tremendous part of the British tradition always to oppose those two thoughts.
Yes.
And it's, for instance, the case of a writer like Nietzsche, to whom, of course, Wittgenstein bears a very strong resemblance in a lot of ways. The literary and the philosophical achievements are not totally distinct from one.
Well, let's take it in a concrete case. Let's take the implications many people have drawn from Wittgenstein, and whether he himself would have approved of them, for religious discourse. I mean, as I understand it, the idea is that religious language is, again, its own form of life with its own criteria, consistent in carrying out certain practices, and it can't be criticised. Now,
I think that's probably a bit hard, but something like that street,
Well, I mean, you can approach it in two ways. Yeah. I mean, one much more comforting to a religious person than the other. It can be said it's true in its own terms, or it can be said the question of truth or falsehood doesn't arise in relation to it. It's simply a form of ritual, and then the only question is whether the ritual is carried out properly or whether it fulfills its function, its emotional function or whatever.
Oh,
now, the second would be discouraging, but the first, if we say it's true in its own terms, would have.
Well, if one's being very Wittgensteinian about it, I'm sure he wouldn't say either of those things. Because to say it's true in its own terms sounds frightfully sniffy. I mean, as if to imply it isn't true, really. And it isn't either true or false. It would be a kind of meta-remark that would be standing outside the whole game. I mean, he would say, rather, what are they at when they say it's true? I mean, I think, actually, as I think Dummett once remarked, the concept of truth plays an extraordinarily small part in the later philosophy of Wittgenstein. Meaning is not connected with truth. In the later philosophy of Wittgenstein, meaning is connected with going on. I mean, it's connected with assent, not with truth. What you discover what the proposition means is to discover what elicits assent from the group, I think, rather than trying to transcend the whole practice to some notion of truth conditions, I think. Of course, Wittgenstein is prepared to say these sentences, these propositions, get their meaning from the form of life in which they're embedded. Well, the form of life certainly exists. And they're going on in this way is what it is to come to understand what these religious propositions mean. But of course, for the believers, and I'm not here quoting Wittgenstein, but one's bound to say this oneself, for the believers, their meaning was supposed to transcend these situations in which they practiced in this way.
It seems to be very odd, because this seems to be to sever meaning from truth.
Yes, but I think that that's what Wittgenstein's theory of language tends to do. I mean, I think they're about acceptance conditions in which other people will say yes, rather than some, as it were, independently conceived truth conditions.
Now, do you think that he thought the question of truth couldn't be raised with regard to these propositions, or just that it wasn't interesting to raise it?
I think he thought that it meant something else in regard to these propositions.
Well, this is what I meant by saying earlier that he represented them as being true in their own terms.
Yes, but true in their own terms would mean there's some way of their counting as true, yes. But in this case, it seems to be so difficult for him or his supporters to say that the picture that so many of the earlier believers had, namely of a reality distinct from them and this world to which these propositions correspond or fail to correspond, so difficult for the Wittgensteinians to say that this was just a wrong picture. Or, let me put it this way, if this was a wrong picture, what it shows is wrong is religion. Not a certain interpretation of religion. I mean, that's the point, isn't it? In this case, you couldn't say religion and all the meaning of religion really exists, but it exists in the practices of this world. Any picture of it corresponding to a transcendental reality is just a false picture, because it was the point of those practices to correspond to a transcendental world. So once you're persuaded that the idea of it corresponding to a transcendental world is nonsense, then what you do is stop engaging in the practices.
But it seems to me that just what differentiates, let's say, philosophy from anthropology, it does ask these further questions.
Well, that's what I think.
And it is that the Vickersinian program just sticks with anthropology.
Well, I think that there is something in this point, and I think further that, oddly enough, it hasn't come to terms with some of the genuinely anthropological problems.
It's just bad anthropology.
Well, in a certain sense, this is, I mean, obviously it's a very one-sided and unfair remark, but in a certain sense it's true. Because, after all, a very rooted problem in anthropology, one which methodologists in anthropology are always coming back to, is what sense can be attached to comparisons between different cultures. Mm-hmm. I just want to say a bit more, but I mean, let's take an example of this. Start with some simple-minded old 19th century utilitarian. Mm-hmm. He goes to Mexico or South Africa, Africa, where it is. He finds people dancing in connection with the rain. He assumes that this is a bad piece of bad science. Mm-hmm.